Church family, those here and present with us today, and those joining us through live stream. We're going to begin our time of worship with some verses from Psalm 107. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy, and gathered out of the lands from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. For he satisfies the longing soul and fills the hungry soul with goodness. And so one more time in verse 15. Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. And that's repeated again throughout that psalm. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for a desire to want to give you thanks and praise. I thank you for a desire to want to worship you every moment of our lives, individually, and then corporately coming together, collectively coming together like this in a time of corporate worship. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you that we can. Thank you for this building. Thank you for this ministry. And Father, thank you for making it possible that our worship can be found acceptable and pleasing to you through new life in Christ, through the work of the Holy Spirit that enables us to worship in spirit and in truth. Father, we do pray for the sick and the afflicted and the needy as the COVID cases continue to climb in our area as well as all across the globe. And Father, more and more people that we know or family of people that we know have it, and some very ill, and we just pray your care upon them. Father, may it be times like this that causes us to realize just how frail life can be, the brevity of life. And God, that we would hear your gracious call and we would respond by faith and we would walk in faith. And God, that we would see the importance of seeking you first in all things. God, we desire for you to be glorified. And I pray that this time together we'll do just that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Amen. 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 For Jesus to be our hope and our stay, what does that mean? We all need hope, right? But you realize, biblically speaking and realistically, there's only one assured hope, and that is the person of Christ. That's why the Apostle Paul would say, Christ in you, the hope of glory. What does it mean that he's our stay? Is he your hope? Banking on him for everything. And then is he your stay? To me, that means the one in whom we build our life upon. To me, it's like the branch abiding in the vine. We come to Christ, we remain with Christ, we stay with Christ. He's our stay. And then to sing that he's our defense in the court of heaven. We are there by the fact of his righteous act, his sacrificial, substitutional, righteous act of giving himself for us. He's our defense. In other words, we're acceptable to God through him. And his righteousness is ours to all who by faith come to him. Turn in your Bibles, if you will, to Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8. As we continue on through this passage, I really should say as we get back to this passage and be here for at least a couple weeks. How does that sound? That would be more accurate, right? We sometimes take detours as I read and pray, and sometimes compelled to get off of where we were at and go to another matter. And so we did spend a couple Sundays in 2 Peter chapter 1 looking at this matter of how we have like faith, like the apostles, equal to them, salvation, all because of the divine power, and that we're brought into the divine nature, that faith is the foundation. And all those things are wrapped in love, as Peter excludes to the things that we are to supplement our faith with. But today we're headed back to Luke, and we're going to finish this chapter. I thought it best to break up the last of these verses, verses 40 to 56, into two settings. You can thank me later for that. To me, what we find here is amazing. We find two completely different individuals with two great needs. We find them both in desperation, and we find them both seeking Jesus in the midst of their affliction, in the midst of their difficulty, in the midst of their devastation. They seek Jesus. And people do that, right? A lot of times people can pay no attention to God as they go through their life until something tragic happens and then they cry out to God. That song we sang, Lord, I Need You. Have you ever thanked God to be in the mindset, to have the disposition that, no, I do need you, God? You realize how many people go through their life, what do I need God for? And then their pride, their arrogance, and I should add, in their ignorance, what do I need God for? Even though he allows their lungs to breathe another breath, their heart to beat another beat, right? His general grace and his general benevolence on all mankind, to those who trust him and those who reject him, he still is gracious and merciful. But to be in a place, where, no, I know I need you, God. I know I need you. And aren't there times when the props get kicked out from underneath us and it's like, whoa, I forgot who was in charge and I forgot where my sustenance lies. It's in you, God, not myself. Well, let's look at this passage today, Luke chapter 8. Believe it or not, we're only going to read verses 40 through 48. Jairus and the situation there, we will talk about that next Sunday, Lord willing. So join with me if you will. We're looking at the life and times according the life and times of Jesus. We're looking at Luke chapter 8, starting with verse 40. So it was when Jesus returned that the multitude welcomed him, for they were all waiting for him. And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue, and he fell down at Jesus' feet and begged him to come to his house, for he had an only daughter about 12 years of age, and she was dying. But as he went, the multitudes thronged him. Now a woman having a flow of blood for 12 years, who had spent all her livelihood on physicians and could not be healed by what, church? Any. Came from behind and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her flow of blood stopped. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" When all denied it, Peter and those with him said, "Master, the multitudes throng and press you, and you say, 'Who touched me?'" But Jesus said, "Somebody touched me, for I perceive power going out from me." Now when the woman saw that she was not hidden, she came trembling and falling down before him. She declared to him in the presence of all the people the reason she had touched him and how she was healed immediately. And he said to her, "Daughter, be of good cheer. Your faith has made you well. Go in peace." Let's pray. Father, I am thankful for the great physician named Jesus. I am thankful for the whole and complete healing that he brings to us. I thank you that he does heal physical needs, emotional needs, but most importantly, our spiritual need, the malady of sin, the sickness of sin, soul, sin, full souls, sick and condemned to die, that you bring healing, Jesus, to us. I thank you, Father, that you are a God of love. You're a God of compassion. You're a God of mercy. You're a God of grace. And I thank you for this narrative here, this historical account during the life and times of Jesus, that in just a short portion of one day, he brought two completely different individuals. He delivered them from their hopeless situation. And help, Father, help people to see Christ as the deliverer, Christ as the rescuer, Christ as the great physician, not only for physical needs, but for our eternal souls. Spirit of God, bring illumination to your word today. Spirit of God, may your word, may it have a great and a saving impact on our minds, our hearts, and our wills today. All for the glory of you, O God, I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Oftentimes, afflictions, crisis, needs of various type can cause some to set aside pride and seek the help of others, right? But not always. Sometimes the pride can just hang on and cause one to absolutely refuse to seek help. In our narrative today, we see two individuals, though, that set all that aside and sought the Savior. Why? Because there was no other hope. There was no other help available to them. When we look at verse 40, and I ask that you do, and it's not on the screen, I'm cutting down on slides for this Sunday. Verse 40 says, "So it was when Jesus returned." So when Jesus returned, what does that mean? How many want to know? One hand, that's enough. No. When we look back, and I realized Jeff Garney was here, and then we as a couple, we as a week, week of 2 Peter, and then Jeff Garney, and then another week. And so all that was taking place. But now we're back. And when we think back to when we were in Luke chapter 8 last, we saw the healing of the demonic man. And the healing was so great and so powerful that it caused the people of that area to be really confused. But not only that, when we look back to verse 37 of Luke chapter 8, it says, "Then the whole multitude of the surrounding region of the Gadareans asked him to depart from them, for they seized with great fear." They were seized with great fear, and he got in the boat and returned. Isn't it interesting? He was sent away from the people on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. Why? Well, they were held in great awe. They just saw this man who had been possessed with demons for a long, long time, completely healed, immediately healed, completely healed, sitting at the feet of Christ in his right mind. They also saw 2,000 pigs or more of theirs go down over the cliff and drown in the sea. So economically, Jesus' miracle of Legion caused hardship, economically speaking, for some. Was it the great fear and awe of the miraculous work that Jesus had done that caused them to want him to depart? Possibly. But I also think of John 3:19, where the latter part of that verse says, "Men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil." Yes, it's amazing what you did for Legion. And we sure don't appreciate what you did for the pigs. But you know what, Jesus? How about just getting out of here? We don't need you. We don't need you here. Well, then we look at verse 40 in our text today. "So it was when Jesus returned that the multitude welcomed him, for they were all waiting for him." So it might have been a day or two, but if you remember, he's done all kinds of preaching, teaching, miracles, and they're following him to the shore, and he gets into the boat, and, "Oh, come back, don't be so long, Jesus, hurry back." And perhaps they even witness the storm on the sea. At any rate, they lingered, they waited. Jesus had a following now. Many people had been ministered to by Jesus. And so you have a hungry crew or a hungry group of people welcoming Jesus back. That sort of sets the stage for today of what's taking place. And so here's this multitude welcoming Jesus back. They had seen, they had heard, maybe some of them have experienced Jesus' teaching, preaching, and healing. And so they're there. They're all there waiting for Jesus, waiting to see what he would do next. Well, verse 41 tells us, "And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue." We'll talk more about Jairus next week and about his 12-year-old daughter. He would not have been a rabbi. He would have been like an elder. He had been in charge of the synagogue as far as the building itself and arranging services and such. But he was a man of status. He was a man of importance in the community. We're probably talking Capernaum. And we see in his desperation of his 12-year-old daughter at death's door, falling before Jesus and begging him to come. Can you only imagine how Jairus felt? Only daughter, 12 years old, this isn't changing. She's on death's door. There's only one hope left here, and that is if Jesus will do something. And so Jairus is begging Jesus. How many's getting the picture? How many of you got this? You're seeing this. You can sympathize with Jairus here. Well, while that is taking place, while Jairus is before Christ on his knees begging, what else takes place? Well, we look in verse 42. "For he had an only daughter, about 12 years old of age. She was dying. But as he went, the multitude thronged." So Jairus begs. Jesus says, "I'll go, Jairus." You know, he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And those who come to him, he will in no wise cast out. God's word tells us that. Jairus falls before Jesus, begs, tells him the situation. Jesus more or less says, "Let's go, Jairus. Let's go." Let's go. And so they're making their way. They're making their way to Jairus' house. And the multitudes, can you picture the multitudes? They're just like mob, you know, shoulder to shoulder, like the Clearfield County Fair going up the Midway 10 years ago. I mean, it's just bump, 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 bump. And during that throng of people, something else takes place. Let's see it on the screen, Eric. Now, a woman having a flow of blood for 12 years, who had spent all her livelihood on physicians and could not be healed by any. So this is an internal hemorrhage of the lower extremities. Could have been a tumor. We don't know. But can we just enter into this? Can we appreciate this? This isn't a 12 days illness. This isn't a 12 month illness. This is how long, church? Can you even imagine? The loss of blood, I don't know my medical terms. Anemia, would that be right? There'd be no energy or very little. You would be so drained. If anybody ever was sick and tired of being sick and tired, this woman would fit that bill, right? That description. But not only that, we need to take in consideration the other aspects of this illness. Because as a Jew, she would be considered unclean. So there would be no social life. There would be no worship life, no collectively coming together, corporately worshiping like this. She would be like a leper, unclean, unclean. And you can read about that in Leviticus 15. I read over it again early this morning just to look at that and all the different things that cause, not, don't do it now, please, that causes a person to be considered unclean. So she's a social outcast. Now let's just try to put that in our thinking. How many of you have ever been guilty of maybe a little, not big, but a little pity party for yourself? Just a little. If there's a woman ever had a right, a person, ever had a right to feel bad about her situation, this is one. I don't know if we can. I suppose others that have various handicaps and impairments and such. But just the 12 years of loss of blood, the fact of being considered unclean, a social outcast, in every way there was a way to feel, she felt horrible. She felt low. And not only that, she's flat broke. She had spent all of her livelihood. She had gone to doctor after doctor after doctor. Now, these weren't guys with cone hats and stars and moons and stuff on their heads. This was the best of what they had at that time. And really, for what they had at that time, the knowledge of the anatomy and such, there were physicians that could help. Luke was a physician. But this woman got no help from any doctor. So now she's in total despair. And to add insult to injury, if you will, there's no money left. It doesn't get any worse. Emotionally, socially, physically, financially, destitute. And then she heard about Jesus. How do I know she heard about Jesus? Well, Mark's account tells us that. If you just want to hold your finger at Luke 8 and Mark's account, in fact, I'm going to have a couple verses up on the screen here in just a moment. But we see in verse 26, she had suffered many things from many physicians. She had spent all that she had and was no better, but rather grew worse. And you'd think, well, the condition is as worse as it can get. This is as bad as it gets. No, it's just continued. So she's on a downhill spiral in every way possible. But look at verse 27. I should have added on the notes or on the screen. When she heard about Jesus. What? Well, it didn't. Where you been hiding at? Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot. You are an outcast. You haven't been mixing with the others. There's no social life because of your condition. I mean, still follow me here. She didn't know. But eventually she heard about Jesus. Many are saying he's the Messiah. He's healing people from all types of infirmities. He's healing them. He speaks with authority. Many believe he's the Messiah. When she heard about that, there was a glimmer of hope. And I believe the Spirit of God put that hope. I believe the Spirit of God who brings light, who brings salvation, the one who quickens our spiritually dead souls, was ministering to this woman. And she knew that she had to go and find this Jesus. Now, what did she do? Well, we'll go back to Luke's account. Go ahead, Eric. Or I guess we'll go to Matthew's account. For she said, this is what she's thinking. And I see great faith in this. Is it a perfect faith? No. No, it's not perfect. And I'll explain that why, or explain why. But she, in her thinking, says, for she said, if only I may touch his clothes, I shall be made well. Immediately, the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of the affliction. Instantly, immediately. Well, in that day and age then, just as there is now, there was this mentality that if a person, this powerful, important person, if you could just get close enough and touch them, you could be healed. You don't have to do anything else. If you just touch their clothes, you can be healed. We don't know what ran through her mind other than this. She believed in all her being that if she could just, that was her mentality, if I could just reach out and touch this Jesus, I don't even have to touch him, just his clothes would be enough. I could be healed. Her faith had action. See, there was this great need. This is what I want us to understand, that needs can be the opportunity to exercise faith. You understand that? How many times things come along in our lives, a great need, a crisis or affliction, whatever, and cause us to really cry out to God? So here is a need that brought about opportunity to exercise faith. I don't know how many times in my life, and I pray they're few and far between now and the Lord taking me home or Him coming back, whichever comes first. But there have been enough times where I've been flat on my face on the floor crying out to God, literally crying out to God, to have mercy and to intervene in this situation. How many of you have ever experienced that? Well, this woman, convinced, totally convinced, that if I can just touch Jesus, if I can reach out to Him in faith, I'll be healed. Totally hopeless situation, right? From every way of looking at this, there's no hope for this woman. Except now, in hearing about Jesus, there is hope. There is hope. Next truth there. Now, when a woman saw that she, and I, yeah, let me read a little bit in this. In trying to keep the slide short, I put too many out. So what we look and what we see in verse 44, this woman came from behind, touched the border of his garment, and immediately her flow of blood stopped. Now, this garment, the hem, the fringe, oftentimes the Jews would wear this outer garment, this square or oblong thing that went over their shoulders. Usually it would have tassels on the four corners. It was a Jewish robe, if you would. It caused the Jews to stand out among the others. You can read about that as well in the Old Testament. And that's what she reached out. She stooped down and just reached out because that was her mentality. If I can just reach out and just, it wouldn't even have to be like an embrace because I'm unclean anyhow. That would make him unclean. If just the fringe, just the fringe. Well, that's what she did. That's what she did, and immediately the blood stopped. Now, again, follow along before we explain verse 47. Jesus said, "Who touched me?" And how many of you would be like Peter in this situation? Come on, for real, Jesus? You see the multitude. We're getting bumped around like we're like sardines in a can, and everybody's getting jostled, and you're asking, "Who touched you?" Somebody touched me. See, this wasn't just a bump. This was an act of faith, and I can tell the difference. This wasn't just flesh bumping flesh. This was faith reaching out, and this is what I have experienced, and somebody, I'm telling you, touched me. Now, the theologians debate about the human nature and the divine nature of Christ, and I understand that to an extent, and I agree with it. Jesus never quit being human, and Jesus never quit being divine. And we read in Philippians 2 where he laid aside his attributes. But we also know that the Holy Spirit lived within. So some say he did not know. Humanly speaking, he didn't know. I agree with that. I agree with that. Another theologian says he asked that just to draw the woman out, to cause the woman to come out onto the scene and say, "All right, it was me." We know that God knows all things, sees all things. We read where Jesus perceived what Simon the Pharisee was thinking, and he knows what's in the hearts of men. We read elsewhere. Jesus, in his human nature, would not have known who touched him. He wouldn't have known that. But regardless of what your belief is as far as did he know who touched him, did he not know who touched him, the narrative tells us this. He says, "Somebody touched me, for I perceive power going out from me." In other words, it cost Jesus something. Yes, his power is immeasurable, and yes, it's endless. But still, when he would work a miracle, when he'd do a sign and wonder, he experienced something. He experienced power being extracted from him. The only thing I can come remotely close to it in understanding is sometimes, and especially funerals, difficult funerals, they can be so draining to me as a pastor, where I feel so completely exhausted, physically, emotionally, mentally, because energy went forth, and exertion went forth. And you might think, well, that's a dumb example, Pastor. In fact, that doesn't have anything to do with it. But, and of course, we minister not only in our own power, but in the power of Christ, the Holy Spirit, working through us. Jesus perceived power departed from him. He knew that. He knew when faith reached out, there was that connection, and he knew it. Now, when we look at verse 47, because he's saying, and picture this, let's get back to the scene here. So Jesus is following Jairus and the multitude, and they're in a big multitude or a big throng, and they're bumping around, and they're going, and all of a sudden Jesus says, "Somebody touched me." Because there wouldn't have been any conversation prior. They're just walking along. They're headed to Jairus's house to heal Jairus's daughter. And Jesus stops and says, "Somebody touched me." What? I'm telling you, somebody touched me. Somebody touched me. And so as he proclaims that, What happens? Here's what happens. Let's read it. Because this is exactly what transpired, and this is what we need to see. In verse 47, now when the woman saw that she was not hidden, she came trembling and falling down before him. She declared to him in the presence of all the people the reason she had touched him and how she was healed immediately. Now, what does this tell us about this woman? Well, it tells us, of course, that she showed great faith. But this is a very beautiful passage of Scripture, I feel. She wanted to do this secretly, sort of an in-and-out type situation. I'll just touch his garment. The throng will just keep moving on to Jairus' house. And as the crowd continues away, here will be this healed woman sitting in the road, weeping with tears of joy. He touched me. Or I touched him, and he healed me. That's not how it went. She was found out. And it wasn't just Jesus and her standing here now. Here's the whole crowd. And I wonder how Jairus felt. His daughter's on death's door. I mean, he's getting this. I'm happy for her, Jesus, but let's go. I don't think it was a very long interruption. Which brings me to the point I want to make. How many of you have ever been ministering or serving and something pop up? Not now. Not now. I'm busy ministering. I'm busy serving. I mean, anybody ever have that happen? Don't you know I got to be serving God? Let me get this. There's purpose in interruptions. I can be very impatient at times. I can have my mind set on something to do. I want to get this done. I want to get this done. And the last thing I want is an interruption. And then just to find out, I'm working in this interruption, Scott. I'm working here. And so when things come up, I mean, Jesus just got to the other, got back on the western shore, and he's back in the air of Capernaum, and he's ministering, and first Jairus comes. Okay. And so we're going to Jairus' house. Now this woman shows up. But it's all good. Because he's ministering to the people. He's coming to do what he had come, or he is doing what he had come to do. And so you and I think it's a lesson to you and I that, hey, I'm yours, God. We pray about divine appointments all the time. I'm yours. I have this in mind today, but if interruptions take place, show me how I can minister in this situation. How many get this? Now back to this woman. What do I see here? I see humility. She came trembling, falling down before him. Can you imagine just a little short period of time this all transpired in? He's back. He's ministering. Jairus. Okay, let's go, Jairus. And then boom. Somebody touched me. And so this woman shows great humility. I also see her confession. Falling down before him, that's humility. She declared to him in the presence of what church? All the people. So there's a public testimony. Yes, it was I, Jesus, but this is why I did what I did. Because I hear you're the Messiah. Because I hear that you can heal. Because I was at my last straw. There was no more hope left in me. I heard of you, and I came. And what does Jesus do? He heals her. She experienced healing. She felt the healing in her body. She was healed immediately. I love what follows. Next verse. And he said to her, I'm glad Jesus wasn't a stuffy religious dude. You know what I mean? How dare you touch me? You just now made me unclean. Who are you to come up in the midst of a crowd and just touch me like that? Which me saying that shows you how we can think, right? At least how I can think. And I don't think you're much different than I am. I don't think. That isn't how Jesus treated her. In fact, he didn't even chew Peter out for saying, I'm telling you, Peter, somebody touched me. He just, polite, loving, caring, compassionate all the time, right? And he said to her daughter, I love that phrase. The paternal love of God, amen? Daughter. What does that statement mean? Daughter, be of good cheer. Your faith has made you well. Go in peace. He's acknowledging her faith. Did her faith save her? Christ saved her. The power is in Christ. The faith was the instrument, the tool in which she received the healing. But this matter of daughter, that the Savior can say, you're a daughter of God. Daughter. Didn't we read a few weeks ago when we were working through Luke's account where he says in verse 21 of chapter 8, he answered and said to them, my mother and my brothers are those who hear the word of God and what, church? Do it. Here's a woman who reached out in faith, reached out to me in faith. And I say she's a daughter. She's a child. She's a child of God now. Thy faith has made thee whole. Thy faith has made thee whole. So again, the healing power came through Christ. We are saved by grace through what, church? Faith. That not of ourselves. The gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Both grace and faith are the gift of God. The saving power is in Christ. The healing power is in Christ. He's the efficient cause, but her faith was the instrumental cause, theologians say. It was what the tool in which she reaching out was enabled to be able to be healed. Enabled to be able to be healed. How's that? And then he said to her, go in peace. So let's talk about faith for a moment. And I love how one person put it. It says that faith is the voluntary living contact of faith is that electrical conductor which alone draws virtue out of him. What? In other words, faith is that connection that you and I are enabled to receive power, salvation, healing through Christ. Faith is that means. The power is in Christ. That divine power, that divine nature. But faith is the means in which we can experience that. So I want you to think about this. You know, Jesus said, look at it on the screen. Your faith has made you well. If you were to fill in a blank, your faith or my faith blank, what would you put in there right now this morning? Would it be like the man who had the demon-possessed son who said, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief? That's probably where my vote would be. My faith isn't perfect. It's far from it, but there is saving faith there. My faith blank. How would you fill that in? My faith is real. My faith is genuine. My faith isn't much faith. I don't have faith, you might say. But I think it's a question to consider. This woman's faith moved her into action. Moved her from being a social outcast like the leper and said, Jesus, if you're willing, you can make me clean. This woman just said, hey, if I can just touch him, I'll be healed. Her faith moved her to action. What does your faith do? How active is your faith? I'm reminded in what it says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. We use this verse from time to time. I'm going to again this morning. Where it says, but without faith it is impossible to please him. That means God. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, meaning he's God, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. When is the last time you diligently sought God. I hope it was this morning. And I hope it's not just in our times of great need, but that we seek Him always. We seek first the kingdom of God. We desire His will to be done, His kingdom to come. We desire Him, and we desire to seek Him with faith, because without faith, it says it's impossible to please Him. Did we see this woman's faith rewarded? Absolutely. Healed immediately. Does that mean we're always going to be healed then, Pastor, if we have enough faith? No. Because remember, the power of healing came through Christ. Her faith caused her to act on that. It was the instrument. It was the tool. We trust God's will. We trust His answers. We trust Romans 8:28, right? We commit it to Him, and we trust Him with it. Are you one who diligently seeks God in faith? Now, the other thing I want us to see is that in calling her daughter, I want you to see that those who come to Christ by faith, we are the children of God, and the blessing of that. Eric, next verse. In John, 1 John 3:1, I quote this a lot, don't always read it, don't always display it on the screen. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us. Just stop and soak in that. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us because it did not know Him. We've been talking a lot about knowing God. You realize the unsaved world don't really know those who know God? I mean, we may work right beside them. We may be around them all the time, live beside them, but they don't really, really know us because they don't really know God. And that's what John is saying, but John is also reminding the people, hey, stop and consider the love of God that you and I are now His children. It doesn't get greater than that we become the children of God. That's not a work that we can do in of ourselves. Do you realize there's only one true child of God? Jesus. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. But wait a minute, you just contradicted. You said there's only one true child of God. There is one born of God, brought forth from God, the unique Son of God. But just as Jesus said to this woman, daughter, everyone who by faith responds to His gracious call, who has been quickened by the work of the Holy Spirit, becomes adopted children. Is that biblical? Absolutely, it's biblical. Eric, last slide for today. We read in Romans chapter 8, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. And those of us who have been born from above know the worth of that, right? Where the Spirit of God with our spirit united, right? Are able to cry out as Jesus did to the Father, Abba, Father, that term of endearment, Daddy, Papa, my dear Father. And that in itself is better than any physical or emotional healing we'll ever experience. The fact that we're taken from being dead in our trespasses and sins and separated from God, now being adopted into God's family. I might not have status. I might not have an important name, but I want to tell you this. I'm a child of God. And yes, I'm adopted. I'm adopted into God's family. We have people in our church, both in this church and Faith Bible, where they've adopted children into their family. That's a blessing. A greater blessing to be adopted, brought into the family of God. And so, this woman's need, and yes, she tarried with this for 12 long years, continual hemorrhaging. and all that came with it. The physical, the emotional, the social, the lack of being able to worship with others, 12 long years. But in a moment, on one day, she interrupts the ministry of Christ. And Christ takes this woman out of her despair and makes her heal, or heals her, makes her completely whole. And gooder than that, ushered her into the family of God, adopted her into the family of God. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that needs, afflictions, crisis can cause us to seek you. Your Spirit can use them to draw us to you. And you can bring us to that place where we fall before you and receive your mercy, receive your grace, receive your healing, receive adoption into your family. Her faith that made her well. Father, I pray that we would be crying out to you and asking you to search our hearts out, and asking you to examine our faith. Am I in the faith? Do I have saving faith? Do I know what it is to be a child of God? Lord, continue to do a work in our lives for your glory and honor. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Father, I praise you for your graciousness. I praise you for your work, the work of your Holy Spirit, compelling us to reach out to you in faith, moving us, stirring us. I thank you for your light and your life that you give. We thank you that Jesus gave all, completely, in obedience and out of love for you, Father, and love for humanity, and that all who call upon him are saved, experience new life, forgiveness, experience that spiritual healing. And thank you for many experience physical healing as well. Thank you that all healing comes from you. Father, help us to continually look to you, not only in our times of need or crisis or affliction, but always. And help us to just be looking for opportunities to minister and to allow the interruptions to not be a means of frustration, but again to see their opportunities to serve. God, thank you for your love. And thank you so much, Father, for life in Christ. In his name I pray. Amen. You're dismissed.